Suddenly, new countries are looking for nuclear partners, even nuclear weapons of their own. And if you think it's no big deal, look at it from this angle. There are 9 nuclear powers on Earth, but now leaders in 7 other countries are openly asking the nuclear question. Another handful are whispering too. That's a massive increase and speaks to rapid changes in unprecedented times. So less than a century after the testing of the first atomic bomb, what would a dramatic cascade of nuclear coverage mean for us all? South Korea's arguably the country under the most pressure due to its neighbor, North Korea. After the Korean War split the peninsula, the United States moved nuclear weapons into South Korea, and South Korea agreed not to pursue its own nuclear arsenal in the 1970s. Sensing an end to the Cold War, President George H.W. Bush withdrew American nuclear weapons from South Korea in 1991. But in the meantime, North Korea moved ahead with its nuclear program, achieving its first nuclear test in 2006, and showing intercontinental ballistic capabilities in the 2010s. This has left South Koreans feeling threatened by their nuclear neighbor, relying on American forces on the peninsula and visits from American nuclear submarines to deter the Kim regime. But as will become a running theme, countries have sudden room to doubt the reliability of their decades-long alliances with the United States. In his first term, President Trump asked South Korea to pay 400% more for American troops stationed there. Close allies of the president suggested South Korean deaths in war would be an exclusively South Korean problem, aka US troops in South Korea might just head home. And the theme has continued. Trump reportedly said in 2021 that he would end partnership with South Korea in a second term. Now back in office, he suggests South Korea doesn't sufficiently reimburse the United States and should pay $10 billion annually.
You know, we don't get reimbursed by much. South Korea too.
South Koreans have generally been supportive of their government achieving its own nuclear arsenal. According to Lammy Kim for the Center for Strategic International Studies, quote, public opinion polls have consistently shown that a majority of South Koreans, often over 70%, support the development of indigenous nuclear weapons. I've placed 2 extra sources in the description. Many in South Korea have long supported homegrown nuclear weapons and taking wartime operational control, OPCON, even when relations with the US were at their strongest, South Koreans supported these things. So really, it doesn't take that much to motivate South Korean leaders to raise the specter of nuclear proliferation. But South Korea has more to consider than just the immediate unpredictability of the president. The United States Congress has passed non-proliferation legislation that puts obligatory sanctions on countries seeking nuclear weapons, including allies. And it's hard to imagine North Korea and its benefactors Russia, and particularly China, standing by once murmurs of active South Korean nuclear pursuit came to light. And were South Korea to go for the bomb, the next domino might be Japan, which also feels threatened by North Korea and China. If South Korea navigates potential sanctions and other backlash, Japan would certainly be taking notes. However, for reasons I'm sure you could guess, Japan has a different relationship with atomic weapons. The country gave up its nuclear ambitions in the late 1960s and has since relied on American nuclear deterrence, a reliance Japanese leaders have played up in the early moments of the second Trump administration. Unlike South Korea, Japan's public is far more weary of nuclear weapons, even American ones used on their behalf. One non-representative survey suggested 70% of Japan's public supports global nuclear disarmament. No surprise given the destruction of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. But this dubious disposition doesn't discount the pressure the Japanese are under as they experience the ambiguity of Trump foreign transactions. The president recently complained that, quote, we have to protect them, Japan, but they don't have to protect us. What makes Japan an interesting case here is that, one, its current prime minister expressed support for developing nuclear weapons, at least before taking office, and two, Japan could acquire nuclear weapons rapidly if it so desired. The country's so-called breakout period from nuclear latency would last roughly 3 to 6 months. Basically, if pressure were sufficient, Japan could be a nuclear country in the blink of an eye. But though the nuclear conversation in Japan and South Korea has become more open, there are no specific plans, and right now there are no nukes stationed in either country. Theirs is a wait-and-see situation, at least out in the open. That's why, to truly understand the fundamental shift we're seeing worldwide, we have to look where nuclear prospects are far more concrete, where leaders are taking initiative, and where nuclear weapons are already scattered. We need to talk about Europe. Let's start with the European country most likely to raise your eyebrow. Germany. No historical alarm bells there. I'm sure it's fine. But Full disclosure, I worked the last 5 years for the German Embassy and Ambassador here in Washington, D.C., and that's why I can confidently report that German foreign policy is not pointed towards homegrown nuclear weapons. German leaders, from West German Chancellor Adenauer in the 1950s to Friedrich Merz today, renounced having German-made nuclear weapons for obvious historical reasons. The 1990 2+4 Vertrag, the treaty regarding German reunification, forbade Germany from developing nuclear weapons. And honestly, it's a little cultural. Large majorities of the German public are opposed to nuclear this and nuclear that. So my imaginary producer is asking me, why in the world are we talking about Germany? Well, that would be because, despite traditional consensus that Germany should neither create nor manage its own nuclear weapons, Germany already has access to nukes, and the country is trending towards access to even more. Let me explain. I'm gonna throw up a map. Here is where between 15 and 20 American nuclear weapons are already located in Germany. They are part of a defense strategy, so-called nuclear sharing, in which the US president has the power to authorize a nuclear strike from Germany that would then be carried by German forces to their target. The idea is that a country thinking of attacking Germany should be deterred, knowing that aggression against Germany could be met by the nuclear weapons of its NATO ally, the United States. It's like with South Korea and Japan, except American nukes are actually on German soil right now. All that to say, Germany is not a nuclear state, but it is a state with nukes on its territory, and it's been that way for decades. Nukes are not new to Germans. But Germany, like the rest of the world, is considering a world in which the United States can no longer be counted upon to fulfill its obligations under Article 5 of the NATO Treaty. The North Atlantic Treaty Organization, a defense alliance founded in 1949, is traditionally led by the United States. The complication comes from the current administration's skepticism of NATO. What if the US formally leaves the NATO alliance? Or even as things stand, what if a NATO country like Germany is attacked and the commander-in-chief of the United States orders the military to ignore any invocation of Article 5 for mutual defense? Just to be clear, this is something Trump said he might do.
Well, I've said that to them. I said, if you're not gonna pay, we're not gonna defend.
And as we're gonna see, even if you do pay, as he says, there's no guarantee the administration will take you seriously. Because President Trump, Vice President Vance, and Secretary of Defense Hegseth have left lots of open questions in the room about the US fulfilling its treaty obligations, the EU has recently voted to empower member states to spend additional hundreds of billions on their own defense. Large EU countries like France and Germany no longer only speak about meeting 2% of GDP for defense spending, as expected for NATO, but as the head of NATO put it, considerably more than 3%, which some countries like Poland already exceed. But European leaders realize that even large amounts of money spent today won't come good for years, and many are worried about Russian action in a short time frame, particularly if the US imposes Ukrainian territorial concessions in exchange for a ceasefire. That would give Russia the let-off it needs to regroup and plan its next expansion. In Germany, this has meant sudden discussion of a return to nuclear latency, that is, the return of nuclear technology that would leave them well prepared to develop a bomb on short notice. More realistic are considerations of sheltering under France's existing nuclear umbrella. In a televised address from early March, under the pretext of American abandonment and Russian aggression, President Emmanuel Macron offered his country's nuclear arsenal for the defense of Europe, and it wasn't the first time. And now Germany's new leader, Friedrich Merz, has warmed to the idea. He's made his goal to strengthen Europe and, quote, achieve independence from the USA. According to Reuters, Merz said, "Sharing nuclear weapons is an issue that we need to talk about. We have to become stronger together in nuclear deterrence." And it wasn't only France's nukes Merz was interested in. He actually said he wanted to speak to both France and the United Kingdom about extended nuclear umbrellas for Germany. That would mean, assuming the US doesn't actually withdraw their nukes, Germany might potentially be under the nuclear umbrella of three different countries. Definitely ironic for a country statutorily and emotionally opposed to nuclearization. Because the Germans are a little hesitant about all this and having the debate out in the open, they're a little easier to read than the Polish. Because of Poland's proximity to Russia and the history of being split apart, the country often seems an eager step ahead of the rest of Europe on defense issues. They already exceed 4% of GDP on defense spending, something President Trump praised them for in his first term.
That is also why we salute the Polish people for being one of the NATO countries that has actually achieved the benchmark for investment in our common defense.
But as I suggested earlier, meeting Trump's demands on defense spending might come with moving goalposts. From Fintan O'Toole's piece in the New York Review of Books, I came across this anecdote, which shows the precarious position Poland finds itself in for supporting Ukraine against Russian aggression. In early March, Poland's foreign minister mentioned on Twitter that Poland pays $50 million per year for Ukraine to have access to Elon Musk's Starlink. He openly worried if access might be cut off, to which Musk responded, "Be quiet, small man." Then Secretary of State Marco Rubio retweeted, quote, "Say thank you, because without Starlink, Ukraine would have lost this war long ago." Okay, there's a couple things going on here. First, Trump administration officials have gone middle school bully on Poland, not because Poland stopped meeting the defense spending target, no. As O'Toole points out, it's likely because Poland's prime minister is no longer of the far right, but rather the EU veteran and transatlanticist Donald Tusk. And second is a little more obvious, Poland is supporting Ukraine, with which the new administration has fostered an antagonistic relationship. So what is Poland to think? They recently tried to be on the good side of presidents in both parties. During Trump's first term, Poland was one of his friendliest European countries. But now, Poland is worried it may have to choose between its relationship with the US or its utmost goal, defending itself against its Russian neighbor. Trump is providing, said Prime Minister Tusk, a profound change of American geopolitics. And that is why the nuclear conversation has emerged in Poland as well. And it is loud. In March, the Polish president came out and said he wants American nuclear warheads on Polish soil, just like Germany has. Would Poland also want France's nuclear umbrella over Poland as offered by Emmanuel Macron? President Duda and Prime Minister Tusk are, quote, talking seriously with France about it. So, yes. And what about Polish nuclear weapons of their own? Also, yes. Eventually, Tusk suggested in a speech to Parliament, Poland must pursue the most advanced capabilities, including nuclear and modern unconventional weapons. Poland's got like a reverse Oprah thing going on. Like, you give us nukes, and you give us nukes, and we give ourselves nukes. Everybody gets a nuke, which is a lame joke, I will admit, but it is a good transition. When I was writing this video, I struggled to figure out which countries to prioritize because the shifts here are just happening so fast, and so many are asking the nuclear question. I didn't mention Taiwan, nor Sweden or Romania. I didn't talk about Canada, of all places, where influential Liberal Party veteran Chrystia Freeland suggested the British nuclear umbrella might be extended to protect the country from Donald Trump. And I didn't mention the atomic powder keg of the Near East, where an Iranian nuclear program would likely lead to Saudi Arabia and Turkish nuclear proliferation. The bottom line is that it's hard not to dip into theatrical language like this is a tectonic shift in geopolitical history, but it must be, and therefore we can't really understand by just looking at each individual country. We need to ask a bigger question. Just 80 years into the nuclear age, what does it mean for us all to have a map filling with nuclear weapons and protection schemes? In their September 2024 piece for Foreign Policy, Dalton and Perkovich asked what would happen next should the United States tacitly or actively support South Korea and other allies acquiring nuclear weapons. They write, quote, "China and Russia would then have a powerful incentive and precedent to look the other way and even assist U.S. adversaries in acquiring nuclear weapons to even the score. There are real dangers." That seems like a level-headed argument. More countries with nuclear weapons logically leads to even more countries feeling the need to seek nuclear weapons. It's mutually assured destruction extended to every national rivalry across the globe. And I bring this up because I also encountered opinions in my research that went the other direction, treated global nuclear proliferation like an issue not worth worrying too much about, not likely, not existential, perhaps even beneficial. For example, South Korea is a trustworthy and responsible ally. If they obtain nuclear weapons, they and North Korea could nuke it out without threatening US national interest. But national interest is myopic in the context of nuclear weapons. If South and North Korea blow up one side of the globe, does the fallout ignore national borders? Admittedly, this is where geopolitical strategy bumps up against something more philosophical, fundamental, the continued existence of humanity. Not naive. I am well aware that we are entering a new multipolar global order. I've covered it a lot on this channel. Post-World War II idealism is extinct. Its institutions are showing cracks. But if we're throwing out the post-war order, there is one particular tradition that needs preserving. The one that believes emphatically that nuclear proliferation is an existential threat. Maybe the US will cease to be the hegemon that enforces that belief in its own interest. It is still a tradition worth reminding people of. In 1955, Bertrand Russell and Albert Einstein published the Russell-Einstein Manifesto, a warning to the world about the brand new nuclear age. We are speaking on this occasion not as members of this or that nation, continent, or creed, but as human beings, members of the species, man, whose continued existence is in doubt. Not long after President John F. Kennedy was faced with a missile crisis, Soviet nuclear arms were being built up on the island of Cuba. As the world feared nuclear annihilation, President Kennedy, notably, did not attempt to disabuse people of the seriousness of the situation.
Nuclear weapons are so destructive, and ballistic missiles are so swift, that any substantially increased possibility of their use, or any sudden change in their deployment, may well be regarded as a definite threat to peace.
Nuclear weapons stretch the definition of national interest beyond its limits. I'm not suggesting things were safer in the Cold War than today. Two superpowers and some friends having nukes wasn't that great either. But instead of marching down the proliferation path, isn't the only reasonable position to advocate keeping the number of nuclear armed states as low as possible to not accept a proliferation status quo? And especially not to just dismiss the risk involved in overlapping nuclear protection schemes. The world's first nuclear detonation was in 1945. The Soviets got the bomb in 49. It hasn't even been 100 years, and now 9 countries are nuclear powers, and now more countries might seek the bomb in one way or another, and we only have the entire remainder of human history to contend with. It only takes one mistake. What if Soviet Premier Khrushchev or President Kennedy had handled the 1962 Cuban Missile Crisis even slightly differently? During the 1973 Yom Kippur War, US forces went to DEFCON 3 with intercontinental ballistic missiles on high alert. Meanwhile, Secretary of State Kissinger was delaying phone calls with President Nixon because he was drunk, or in Kissinger's words, when I talked to the president, he was loaded. In 1983, a Soviet radar system falsely detected US ICBMs. Lieutenant Colonel Stanislav Petrov correctly surmised it was a mistake and ignored the procedure that would have alerted superiors up the chain to initiate a nuclear counterstrike. That's just a few examples from two countries in less than a century. Now, imagine not just the tactical gamesmanship, but the clumsy accidents that might occur with substantially more countries possessing nuclear weapons. And weirdly enough, that is the relative stability we face losing in this multipolar world order. That's the danger we face. A few generations from now, what of our era will have made a difference for those that come next? The longevity of democracy and our rule of law? Yes. The action we take on climate change? Yes. The spread of nuclear weapons? Yes, yes, yes. The world might realign, fine, but it would be a tragedy to let our moment of geopolitical realignment distract us from an existential issue like this. Less than a year after the 1962 Cuban Missile Crisis, President Kennedy continued his warnings about nuclear proliferation around the world. He writes, "There would be no rest for anyone, no stability, no real security, and no chance of effective disarmament. There would only be the increased chance of accidental war, and an increased necessity for great powers to involve themselves in what otherwise would be local conflicts." Be it a superpower or a great power, there is no checking out from the nuclear issue. There is no national interest. Heads held high, happy warriors. Eyes open. Later, y'all.
For this generation, ours, life is nuclear survival.